Fredclarkeara After Dark Black Pearl. Welcome to this CareCollab. Thank you so much for clicking on this video. I am very excited. I am very, very excited. Clearly, not because of just the bloom spectacle, but yes, I'm very excited that my After Dark Black Pearl is in bloom for this CareCollab. I'm teaming up today with Karin's Orchids and Yuri Simon. I want to say thank you very, very much to the ladies for getting in touch with me, for making me aware that they have this orchid as well. Their links will be in the description below as soon as and when I see their videos. In the meantime, I will have their channel links in case you see this video and I have not seen their videos. But this CareCollab is giving me a great deal of pleasure, and I just wonder how much time have you got? Sometimes some things are just so beautiful that, you know, what is there to say, but just have a look-see and stare. And in this case, a smell. As I'm standing almost 4 feet away from this orchid, the ginger smell is incredible and intense, and she doesn't need the sun at all to exude that fragrance. It is intense the whole day, no time specified. It's wonderful. She lives with me at this point in time indoors in my dining room area, but to get her to bloom like this, I think that my east side is going to be her forever home once she comes out of dormancy after the blooming has finished. I start her on a very low shelf when she breaks dormancy, and then as the leaves progress and when I start watering, she moves up to the middle shelf. And once she's hardened enough by the bright, bright light that comes in on that side for approximately 8 hours a day during that time of year, then she moves to the top shelf of the east side staging or rack area. And I have mine in self-watering with Leca. Let me bring her in. That's all I've got. I don't have anything else in there. I find that this has worked perfectly for me. It is the first time that I've gotten her to bloom. So I've had her almost 3 years now, and the self-watering in the Leca was, for me, super, super water retentive, and it could drink as much as it wanted all the time. I found that in the early stages of when you begin watering, I find that they don't drink as much as I would have expected. It is only towards the latter stage of the growing, and then when the bulb starts to develop and get fat, that is when they start to really drink a lot, and I have to fill the reservoir, which is about to here, every second day. But prior to that, when I filled the reservoir, I found that I had about 4 to 5 days before it was completely absorbed. And just when the bulb started to really fatten up, that is when it was like really guzzling in that water and the nutrients. And when I'd speak about nutrients, I fertilize at 300 parts per million with every watering. When the reservoir has been absorbed, I do flush the pot through twice using the outer mask as a measure with plain RO water. Inside this pot, probably now 2 years old, is Osmocote, slow-release fertilizer, like I would say a US tablespoonful, just sprinkled through the middle of the pot and not through the top. I just have it like in a layer down here. But I have to also say that by now I am almost certain that the second year that Osmocote was all used up, and I haven't repotted this orchid since I've got her. And I don't think I'm going to repot this year either, depending on how the new growths are going to come out. Let me just touch the bulb first. I don't want that structure to get hot, but it's nice and cool. I don't want my bulbs to burn. So I haven't replenished the Osmocote, clearly, because I haven't repotted it. And I probably will not repot it this year either, because there's plenty of room in the pot for another growth. As far as I can see, that shouldn't be a problem. It'll be a little bit more of a challenge when it comes to watering, but you know, for the time being, the global situation is what it is. I've got time and I can be on top of it. But when I say when I start to water in self-watering, you see, the principle of self-watering in Leca is you don't ever want the Leca to dry out. And then there's this thing with catasetums that you want them to dry out while they are dormant. So are you losing the retentive effect of the Leca and the wicking effect of the Leca by letting them dry out? In my case, I don't let her dry out all the time too much. Right now, because she is in bloom, the pot is pretty dry. I have not watered for a long time. So let's have a look-see if I can without destroying my blooms. Yep, this is dry. The microfiber is absolutely dry. So have I lost the wicking effect of my Leca? In the past years, no. Because when it comes time to water her, I will have the water in the reservoir touching the base of my pot. And that way I'm going to start the wicking process anew. First, flush through with plain R water because of any kind of dust, debris, mineral deposits over the months of no watering. So a good flush will be the first watering for this orchid when it is time, after she has developed new growths. And after that, the water will be touching the base, kind of submerged into the reservoir so that I can start getting the wicking action back into the Leca. And how do I know how and when to water? Because the roots have to be a certain length. You know, you don't want to water too soon. The leaves should be leafed out and all these factors and principles of timing. Clearly, I can't see any root action in my pot. I can only see what will happen at the surface, but my pot doesn't allow me to see anything. I will know by weight. I will know by how it is leafed out on the top. I will know by how shriveled are my other bulbs becoming. So this is all a step and observation process, even now while she's in bloom. And I'm watching these bulbs carefully. They are not shriveling at all because of the bloom display. And if she needed water, I would give her a flush at this point in time, just to hydrate those roots in there a little bit more. But she doesn't need it. These bulbs are not shriveling. So when it comes time to figure out, do I water her or not, depending on her growth pattern, I know the weight of my pot. If roots are growing in and they're growing in and settling in to the environment down there, my pot is going to get heavier. Only a smidgen, granted, only a smidgen, but I know her weight. I know she is so much heavier now because of the blooms. She really is heavy, it's astounding. But I also know how much she weighs once the blooms are gone. So it'll be the bulbs that will show me if they're getting too shriveled. I'm not so concerned about the back bulbs and the shriveling there. They might eventually fade away and deplete themselves. It shouldn't really happen, but it can. It's this bulb that I will be watching. And if she happens to put out another growth in the back here, oh, I'm getting sticky with happy sap. In the back here, that might be another option for another growth. That bulb I shall monitor as well. So depending on the shrivel of the bulbs and the weight of the pot is when I'm going to judge when to start initiating watering. And I will initiate watering with a good thorough flush. And then if the roots and the weight of the pot shows me it's time to water, I will be submerging the base of the pot into the level of the reservoir so I kickstart the wicking action again. So that is how, for the time being, I'm observing her. I've got her status locked in my mind. Of course, I've got pictures, but that is the factor for me when all my catasetinae come back into growth, weight of the pot and watching my bulbs. But when it comes to the blooms, now I have had an experience with a first-time bloomer that I got female blooms. And this might be really hard to film. I've been around the block 2 or 3 times trying to find the right place for filming, and the shade doesn't do it justice. Indoor doesn't do it justice. I am hoping that this is going to work. You know, how do you film a black orchid? Well, you do the best you can. But when it comes to the blooms, male blooms, female blooms, my first time bloomer of all my catasetini, and yep, I only have three at this point in time, but they were female blooms. And apparently that is a very, very happy catasetum to bring forth female blooms and should not be scoffed at. So yeah, I'll take it. They were super interesting. And this one had no different treatment to the Jack of Diamonds that bloomed as female blooms first. It had the same amount of light. It moved up to the top shelf at the same time as all the others did. And it's given me male blooms, of which of course I'm super grateful because I've really wanted to see this orchid in real life. But the light is intense. I have her for about 3 months of the year during the hottest times, exposed to direct sun, and it's fine because it's very, very breezy. But for southern Spain, that is a lot of light. Granted, she's on the top shelf, so her hours are a little bit diminished because there is a slight overhang. But up there, with the reflection of the wall, similar as to what you see here, the light intensity is astounding, and still I get male blooms. And that for me is absolutely fine. I can get female blooms on other catasetini. These guys, I really want to just have these male blooms. They are absolutely something else, to say the least. Taking forever to open. I have babied these two spikes since I think it was end of November. Sorry for the jiggling, I've got a puppy at my feet. End of November, and then the buds came, and then we had Christmas, and it was just dragging out. But I only lost one bud, which was on this spike over here, and all the others have as yet to open, but they don't look like they're going to blast. But the progress of these blooms, yeah, your patience is tested, at least mine is. So I'm hoping that you can see the detail on them. The fragrance, oh my goodness, I was touching upon that before. The fragrance is this gorgeous, gorgeous ginger, very heavy on the ginger, but with a little bit of sugar as a back note. But if you get really close and really stick your nose in and want to get the whole experience, I can say it clears your sinuses. It's like one of those cough drops or throat pastilles that you get at the pharmacy, and it just, woo, clears your sinuses. It's amazing. I have nothing else but good to say about this fragrance. The happy sap that develops during the summer that hangs on to the leaves is just as predominant now while in bloom. It has never stopped producing happy sap. I have, where she lives, drops of happy sap on the shelf. It's just never ending. They drop the happy sap on the other bloom, and they're just all over the place, and it's beautiful, beautiful to see. I am so happy, I cannot tell you, that I have her in bloom for this care collab. As I mentioned, I have no intentions of repotting her, not this year, maybe not next year. It can happen that one will want to repot every single year, but as long as she's happy, as long as she's got space, I'm leaving her in that pot to do her thing. These are the easiest to transition over into this method, especially when they come out of dormancy. It's just a question of potting them up, securing them with a stake, which I have like right here, which is fastened to one of the holes at the bottom of the pot, and then tying a pseudobulb there, and don't move, or as little as possible, while the roots go down. The new roots that come, they will just adapt straight away into this new media, despite the fact it might have come from bark or sphagnum moss before. One of the easiest orchids I find to have transition into semi-hydro, when it wakes up, it won't know anything different has happened. In the summer, with all this happy sap that you see, you can also imagine what the leaves are like, and it's a sticky mess, which can attract quite a few pests. In my case, I get a lot of ants, and they are welcome to the happy sap as long as they don't start nibbling at my leaves. I have not seen mealybugs on this orchid, but I do and am able to shower her almost every day when it comes to watering. I don't have to worry about anything going into the crown, into the leaves, and rotting anything. My air is so dry, so hot, I can take my sprayer and literally just give the orchid a shower every single day. And that is what I do. It doesn't contain the happy sap, but it makes it much easier at least to wash the leaves off every once in a while. I don't know how good this is going to be with the blooms. Trust me, I've been everywhere to see how can I film her best to make her more favorable. This is the best I can do. I hope I've done her justice, and I hope that maybe next year things might have changed in my setup that I can give her the full professional lighting, etc. But for now, trust me, this is black. I have seen others that have a little bit of a burgundy tint to them, maybe a little bit in the sun. There's a little bit on the pollen there of burgundy. But for me, this is as black as it's going to get. Thank you very, very much for your time. I really appreciate it. Thank you to Karin's Orchids and Nuri Simon. I appreciate you joining in on this Care Collab. I look forward to seeing your orchids. And if anybody else watching this video now and does videos would like to join in on future updates, join in on the Care Collab, please email me. My email is in the description below, and then we can get in touch and I'll put you into the column for the Fredclarkeara After Dark Black Pearl for future updates. I would really, really welcome this. Have yourselves a wonderful day. I appreciate your time watching this video, listening to me geek out over my Fredclarkeara After Dark Black Pearl. Thank you so very, very much. Take care and stay safe. Bye.